Good morning, everybody. James Irsay here. It's time for Morning Irsay, and we have a special guest who has been here before, and we always love it when she comes, and that's Lisa Yui, who is a pianist. You know about Lisa. She's a Yamaha artist, lecturer. She teaches at the Manhattan School of Music, and she's also on the piano faculty at Montclair State University. She's won all kinds of competitions and played with all kinds of orchestras in all kinds of places, right? Lisa has been around. And she is also a writer. Her last presentation was on humor. Well, maybe not your last, but a recent one was about humor and music. She's great. We love it when she shows up here. She produces the series at Manhattan School of Music, Lives of the Piano. And it's now in its 19th year. We know she loves all kinds of music, and she likes film noir. And if it's trashy, she'll go and see it. Lisa. Let's check out and see if you're actually here.
Good morning.
All right, we're all set. Lisa,
good
welcome.
Morning. Thank you for inviting me.
What are we going to be doing today? Surprise me.
Well, surprise, we'll be discussing Schubert's Wander Fantasy, which is one of his most, or perhaps his most extroverted, most brilliant, and certainly technically most demanding work for solo piano. Shall we play maybe a little bit of the opening? This is a recording by Clifford Curzon from 1949. This is the first movement of Schubert's Wander Fantasy. So that's a little taste of more to come. The Wander Fantasy was composed in 1822, and this is a rather significant year because the following year, 1823, is going to be the beginning of many, many challenges for Schubert. This is when the symptoms of the first stages of syphilis sets in, and it's quite painful to read about him. His life in the years 1823 and 24. But still, in 1822, you hear this incredible optimism and energy and youthfulness in this piece. So a little bit about the title. The Wander Fantasy, it's kind of a strange title, two parts. The fantasy part tells you that although it's in four movements, it's not a sonata in the 18th century sense, but it uses a very, very original structure that we can talk about later on. And Wander, from the first part of the title, comes from a song that Schubert had composed back in 1816. The song was composed in 1816. It actually was published in 1821 as part of Opus 4. And as you know, there was another song called Das Wandern, and Der Wander, sorry, Das Wandern is another song.
There's three Wanderer songs.
There are three Wander songs, yeah. So Der Wander, there's a song from 1819 whose text is by Schlegel, and there's also Das Wandern.
That's which, the opening of the Schönemüllerin.
Die Schönemüllerin, yes, yeah. And that's from 1823.
And that's a jolly song.
It's a jolly song, and even the song from 1819, there's a certain lightness mm-hmm. to it. This version, whose text is by von Lubeck, is, I think it's much greater than it's darker certainly than
Absolutely.
The other two.
The structure is much more complex.
It's much more complex, yes. And so 1816, that makes him not quite 20 years old. He's only 19, but you have to remember that in 1816, he had already composed 5 symphonies, over 300 solo songs, which would make it more than half of his surviving total, 4 comic operas, 4 masses, 7 string quartets, and a whole bunch of lesser pieces.
That's another Liszian aspect of him, because Liszt also was an incredible producer like that, burning constantly. You know,
he was. Liszt certainly was, but Liszt, if you take his works from age 16, it did not have the
maturity
sensitivity
kind of, yeah,
and
yeah,
the maturity right. that Schubert did.
Absolutely.
I think Schubert was, in many ways, the greater child prodigy when it comes mm-hmm. to even technical mastery and definitely emotional maturity.
Well, I guess also Liszt was very busy at that age, as any pianist would be, mm-hmm. firming up his technique that he's going to need for the rest of his life. So he probably spent a lot of time, you know, practicing
yes.
as opposed to more than composing.
And their personalities were incredibly different as well. And Liszt was more intent on pleasing the public and showing off, and
I'm a servant of the public.
Certainly the public, and that was his attraction as well. But Schubert had a much, much different, much more introspective personality. And his songs from ages 16, 17, the Earl King, for example, or Gretchen at the Spinning Wheel, this is maturity of a freakish level.
Yeah, amazing.
And yet, by 1816, when he was a mere teenager and he had composed this huge output, there has not been a single work yet that has been published. There has been not a single public performance in Vienna, and not even a public notice in the newspaper at this point, which is kind of amazing. So before, I would love for your audience to hear the song, but I'd like to read the text of the song first by Lubeck. And I envy people who could listen to this music and listen to the text without actually knowing what it sounds like, because I think it's fascinating to hear the words and imagine how a composer may interpret these words. So let me read to you the text of the song. I come down from the mountains, the valley dims, the sea roars. I wander silently and am somewhat unhappy, and my sighs always ask, where? The sun seems so cold to me here, the flowers faded, the life old, and what they say has an empty sound. I am a stranger everywhere. Where are you, my dear land, sought and brought to mind, yet never known? That land so hopefully green, that land where my roses bloom, where my friends wander, where my dead ones rise from the dead, that land where they speak my language, O land, where are you? I wander silently and am somewhat unhappy, and my sighs always ask, where? In a ghostly breath, it calls back to me, there where you are not, there is your happiness. Not a cheerful song, but there is, you can't simply say it's a depressing, you know, text. There is so much. There's hope, there is passion, there's isolation, there's devastation. And we have already the sense of Schubert's attraction to being an outsider to the world in many ways. This is a prominent theme in Schubert's music throughout his life.
It's a prominent theme in other people's music as well. It's a great theme. You know? Think of the Alto Rhapsody
theme
of Brahms and things like this.
But
you know,
particularly with Schubert, it's not mere devastation. There is this kind of a smile through the tears. And mm-hmm. with Schubert, I always got the sense that there's so much dance and song in his music, but he's never a participant. He's always observing from the outside into the world, and he finds it beautiful, but he's not dancing along with them. Mm-hmm. So let's listen to the song. And this is a performance, a very famous performance of Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau with Gerald Moore on the piano. what an original novel structure this is, right? It's such a complex song with so many different emotional states. You have this rather an image of isolation and devastation in the beginning, and you have this dance-like rhythm in the middle where he talks about this land that he's searching for. And then in the end, it's an almost a kind image of death, so to speak. And this is also an image that he uses quite often, as death as not someone terrifying, but as a comforting friend, mm-hmm. so to speak. And I had mentioned this interest of Schubert, this sense of being an outsider from the world. But there's a letter from 1818 where he expresses this feeling incredibly well. He's writing to a friend while he is tutoring some students in Hungary, then Slovakia. And he writes here, "Not a soul here has any feeling for true art. So I am alone with my beloved," he's talking about his art, "my beloved, and have to hide her in my room, in my pianoforte, and in my breast. Although this often makes me sad, on the other hand, it elevates me the more." And it's a beautiful feeling that I think many artists understand, of this feeling of being an alien in this strange land surrounded by people who no one understands you, and yet this feeling of comfort and of treating the art almost like a lover.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the middle section, early on in the song, we heard this beautiful 8-bar melody where he talks about the sun seems so cold to me here, the flowers faded, the life old. And this melody is the very important quote that he uses in the second movement of the Wanderer Fantasy. And he gives a direct quote of it in the very, very beginning. Let's listen to the opening of that second movement once again, Clifford Curzon performing. So that's pretty much a direct quote from the song, same key. Curzon performs it much, much slower, but this is probably the darkest section of this entire piece. Schubert has quoted his own songs in a larger work in the Trout Quintet, for example.
Yeah.
This is from 1819. And later on, he does this in the string quartet Death and the Maiden in mm-hmm. 1824 as well. Both songs, Di Forelle, The Trout, and Death and the Maiden, are songs from 1817. So around the same time as this song, The Wanderer.
I just wanted to mention something that
Please.
Is astonishing to me, and it's uh-huh. something that Liszt did not follow through in his arrangement of this. That this is actually written in cut time, 2 beats to the measure.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Do you know how slow those beats are?
The way Curzon plays them.
No, the way they're, well, yeah.
Yes.
But generally, I mean, nobody can play them anything other than unbelievably slowly, because it's one and two and.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So the beat is one, two.
Well, I think that's too slow, personally. You listen to the song as well, and which is also in cut time.
Mm-hmm.
I think the singer would die, you know, unless you have great breath control.
Yeah, of course. It's also interesting that the way it's quoted in the fantasy is really kind of trimmed down to the essentials. You know, it's more florid in a way in the song, whereas this is really more the basic structure. You know, the spine of the melody, rather than the.
Removes the little filigree
in
the song. Yes,
mm-hmm.
Maybe that's because this movement eventually becomes almost like a variation,
mm-hmm.
and he becomes very, very elaborate later on in the movement as well.
Quite.
And he does only use these eight measures from the song,
right.
And essentially he repeats the melody over and over again, becoming quite technically challenging.
Yeah, it certainly moves to new places, doesn't
yes,
it?
Yes, yes. Really a wonderful, wonderful song. So let's talk a little bit about what makes this piece, the actual piano fantasy, so original. There's the virtuosity, first of all, which is really brilliant and very exciting for the listener and the performer as well. So it's in four movements, which automatically causes a very casual listener to think that it's a type of a sonata. But it has a feel of a sonata with a very brilliant first movement, the slow movement that we just heard, an obvious scherzo-like third movement,
mm-hmm.
and a virtuosic fourth movement. But one very telling aspect is that there's not a single movement in what we would call a sonata form, which is a language, a musical language that Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven all embraced very fully. The unifying element is the rhythm of the song, the dactylic rhythm of
Absolutely.
The long, short, short, which appears in every single movement. And even if we don't hear the actual quote of the song in the outer movements, that rhythm is obsessively repeated throughout the entire piece. And this really is the unifying element
mm-hmm.
of the entire piece. He calls it a fantasy, which essentially in the Baroque sense is usually a single movement work that's somewhat divided into several sections, but it really is a one movement piece. And so I think it's almost incorrect, if you want to be really, really picky, to say that the Wanderer Fantasy is a four movement piece. It really should be a one movement piece that's in four parts.
Mm-hmm.
There are certain melodies that reappear in later movements, and it feels incomplete to simply kind of play one movement and without the other three.
It's interesting that in the history of the fantasy, it was often used when somebody improvised that they were actually playing what they would call a free fantasy.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. There was actually, well, you know, a prelude and fugue, for example. A prelude is supposed to be a type of a fantasy, was often improvised. And there were people who, it seems a little useless to do this, but there were books of fantasies that were published for people who were not very good at improvising. And so you could kind of pretend to improvise. And it was also a wonderful way for people to take a theme or an idea and let the imagination kind of open up and go where you will with it. And so this piece kind of has the illusion of that kind of improvisatory fantasy, which you hear very clearly in the slow movement.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it's incredibly tightly composed. Was there a precedent of this quasi-sonata or multi-movement piece and fantasy. Of course, usually if we ask about who was the first to do this and this, it's very often Beethoven. Beethoven, back in 1801, he published the Opus 27 sonatas, which were given the title Sonata Quasi Una Fantasia, or a sonata in the style of a fantasy. The more famous Opus 27 number 2 is the sonata that we today know as the Moonlight Sonata, with the very, you know, famous first movement, which is in every single massage parlor soundtrack. And I wouldn't know, but I would imagine it's definitely in music for relaxation or mm-hmm. music for nighttime, romantic music, right. and so forth. But I think the first of the pair, Opus 27, number one, is in many ways the more revolutionary, and it should be performed much more frequently. Opus 27, number one, the 13th sonata of Beethoven, is like the Wander Fantasy in four sections or four movements, with a rollicking first movement with almost like a German dance-like middle section. The second movement is a slithery scherzo with the most exciting galloping middle section. I'm just whetting your appetite because we're going to play the whole piece. The third
movement.
What a
wonderful piece, too.
It's a wonderful piece. It's really underrated in many ways.
I think so, too.
Because I think the structure is so weird that people can't quite grasp it, and so when they can understand something, people tend to reject it.
There's such one that Beethovenian humor, you know.
Oh my goodness, that middle section of the second movement.
Exactly.
How could you
That's
not
right.
get up? I mean, we can't get up here and dance, but the listeners can. The third movement is almost like an introduction. It's a transcendental, mystical movement, which leads up to a wonderful, energetic final movement, which contains some fugal elements as well. But once again, it's a mistake to call it a four-movement sonata. It's a fantasy, as Beethoven was wise enough to recognize. Why is it a fantasy? The end of each movement is not marked with a double bar. Beethoven writes, attacca subito, which means go straight into the next movement without stopping. And the only complete final cadence is at the very end of the fourth movement. Now, before we listen to this, I want you to really remember the melody of the introductory, the third movement, because it's going to reappear right before the end, at the end of the piece, the end of the fourth movement, except this time it's in the tonic key of E-flat major. And that moment is, it's like a homecoming, right? It's like an apotheosis. And there's a certain sense of relief when we hear that melody right before the brilliant coda.
You know, there's an interesting aspect of that return, mm-hmm. of the melody coming back in E-flat. Because right before the movement, previous movement, the third movement, we're in a descending chromatic series of notes mm-hmm. that is going B-flat, A-flat, and you're expecting a G. But then it goes to a B down an octave and goes da-dum, da-da-da. So
yes.
it's like an interruption.
Yes.
But then
yes.
when you get to the return of that slow movement theme just before the end of the piece, mm-hmm. that's where the G is. So mm-hmm. it's almost as if the third movement is kind of a taking up a space between the resolution, where the resolution of that of that descending chromatic series of notes is.
Fascinating.
Right? I mean, it's like it's, dee, da, da. Wait a minute, I want to do this first.
Yes, 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 yes. And he has the florid cadence at the end of the repeat of the introduction as well, which leads naturally into the E-flat major. This piece is brilliant, I think, because it sounds, as you were mentioning, kind of like an improvisation, but it is so tightly composed. we don't have to get in. Well, that's the beauty of it. You don't have to analyze it in order to appreciate it. But once you do analyze it, you start seeing how he prepares for a key in the previous movement, and it's almost like a foreshadowing of the next key. So let's listen to the entire sonata of the Opus 27, number 1 in E flat major. This is a performance by Emil Gilels on Deutsche Grammophon.
Do you mind if I make one other quick comment about this?
No.
Don't say yes.
It's your show.
And that is that I thought that your deciding to make a comparison between Opus 27, number 1, and Beethoven and the Wanderer Fantasy was really very brilliant.
Oh.
I don't know
mm-hmm.
if it's been done before, but mm-hmm. the fact is that just from the optics of looking at the page of the opening of the Wanderer Fantasy and the opening of the Beethoven, it's the same,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
There are so many similarities. They're both kind of Roman numeral kind of pieces, you know? It's a 1-5-1, you know, very basic harmonies.
You're absolutely right. I'm glad you mentioned it because the you'll notice in this sonata, especially the opening, the harmonies are almost stupidly simple.
That's Beethoven.
Right? Yeah.
That's what he's good at.
But he's not always like this, but when the structure is complex, Beethoven simplifies the harmony. He knows very, very well not to overwhelm the listeners. And you'll find that when the structure is very simple, he would actually make the harmonies much, much more complex. And another similarity, I think if you listen to the final movement of this Beethoven sonata, there is a certain simple elemental energy to it, which reminds me a lot of the Wanderer Fantasy.
Of the last movement of the Wanderer
Fantasy. Yes, yes, yeah. Or even the first movement as well.
And another similarity in these two pieces that's hard to pass by is that, for example, in the Wanderer Fantasy, whatever you hear in the first three measures is all you need for the whole piece.
It's what
Beethoven is good at. And
yes.
in the Beethoven
uh-huh.
also, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. You've got that bum, 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 then you have da 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 da. That's the whole first movement right
yes.
there. You know?
Yes.
And that's another thing that Beethoven is great at is minimizing his materials. It's like having a cooking challenge and see what can you make with these three ingredients, you know?
Yes. I read somewhere that with Beethoven, the beauty is one could actually hear what he's doing. Right, you could hear the technique in certain ways. So the language is very simple, but he creates magic out of the simplicity.
Absolutely.
So, shall we hit it?
Let's hit it. All right, I've expended myself. Here comes Beethoven.
Thank you. Thank you.
doesn't get much better than this, right?
Gorgeous.
So much in there. We were just talking about how symphonic this final movement is, very much like the fourth movement of Schubert's Wanderer Fantasy. And then we have definitely an operatic element as well in that slow improvisatory filigree near the end.
Mm-hmm.
So how could we popularize the sonata so that more people play it? We should give it a nickname, right?
Oh, all right. That's a good idea. We should have a contest.
Contest.
Listener
yeah.
contest.
Yeah. Choose a word. Choose a nickname and then... And then translate that to French, so because all nicknames have to be
right.
Yeah. So if it's not like joy, it's like la joie.
Mm-hmm.
But the humanity of Beethoven, the vitality, the creativity, the simplicity, the complexity, it's all here. It's a delight to listen to.
Yeah, the music, it sounds like a cliche, but in Beethoven, and especially in a movement, it's laughing, but the music seems to have a life of its own. You mm-hmm. don't get the sense that it was written by somebody. Mm-hmm. You just get a sense that it's making itself known to the world, you know?
Yes, and I think it was maybe a conscious decision for him, because I teach a theory course on the Beethoven sonatas. And when you actually trace the output of his piano sonatas, you see very clearly that with every single sonata, Beethoven is pushing himself to try out new ways to have a different language, to have a different voice. And in this sonata, you can see how definitely he's experimenting with the four-movement sonata form, but also with harmony as well. He's moving away from the tonic dominant, the 1-5 movement, which has been prevalent in Western music for certainly decades, if not centuries. And now he's moving into the third relation. So, for example, E flat major going to C major instead of the dominant. And Schubert does the same thing in the Wanderer Fantasy.
Yeah.
Yes. So definitely, I mean, I believe very strongly that Schubert studied these sonatas and was consciously influenced in his own works.
And we were noticing before that the sonata before and after this begin with slow movements,
mm-hmm.
and he was clearly aware that the classical sonata was done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, stick a fork in it, you know.
Yes. And what you see in the Opus 27 sonatas, especially with the Moonlight Sonata, Opus 27, number 2, is that he moves away from the typical decrescendo of the sonata movements, of the first movement being the big muscular work, and then it becomes kind of lighter as as we get to the final movement. It may be more virtuosic, but it's not as emotionally heavy.
Yeah, it becomes sprightly at the end.
Yes, a virtual, you know, you want the applause. But with Opus 27 sonatas, he actually crescendos into the final movement. And so this is a really exciting new way of treating the multi-movement sonata.
Mm-hmm.
So let's finally, after an hour, start talking about Schubert's Wanderer Fantasy, right?
Oh, are we going to be talking about the
Wanderer
Fantasy?
I think that's the piece we're talking about, yes. And so what are the similarities between this Opus 27, number 1, and Schubert's Wanderer Fantasy? They're both in four movements or four sections, if you want to be really picky about it, with unifying elements, right? There are certain ideas that hold it together. So with Beethoven, you have the connected movements, the movements that must be kind of played without pause between the movements, and also the melody that reappears in different parts of a later movement. And with Schubert, you have the unifying, the long, short, short dactyl rhythm. And this, and also with Schubert as well, you have certain rhythmic motives or even melodies that reappear in later movements as well. But Schubert personalizes the Wanderer Fantasy even further by inserting his own song into one of the movements, the second movement. And I think we had mentioned the symphonic element of Opus 27, number 1, and I really love performances that treat the Wanderer Fantasy like a symphonic set of variations rather than a piano piece. Because if you treat it like a piano piece, it becomes almost like a kind of like a set of exercises, you know, arpeggios and scales. And it's such a difficult piece that it's easy to focus on that. And often, especially pianists who are capable of mastering these challenges, tend to play rather dryly with very little pedal. And I find that rather brittle and harsh to listen to. I think we need to treat this as a symphonic work, almost a symphonic transcription.
We'll have more to say about that later.
We certainly will. But in the meantime, let's finally listen to an entire performance of Schubert's Wander Fantasy. And this is a very famous recording by the Italian pianist Maurizio Pollini, recorded on Deutsche Grammophon in 1974. And I think he, especially back in the 70s, Pollini was known as this steely pianist, right? And I think he approaches this piece in that way, but I really like it because you can hear from the opening chords how he uses the pedal. He pedals quite heavily in the opening chords, and I think he understands that this piece must be approached as a symphonic work with much resonance instead of a dry set of churning exercises.
Yet still, he brings out the elements very clearly.
Oh, yes. I mean, Pollini is a master of clarity, and he he's an incredibly intelligent musician. And he, all the sections, all the instrumentation of this piece is very clearly defined. I think this recording is a great introductory recording for many people who are not familiar with this work. And then you can kind of move on to a little more adventurous, daring works. But I think there's very little to criticize about this performance. It's so masterfully played.
If you're not convinced at the opening movements, by the time we get to the last movement, you're thinking, go Maurizio, right? And all those arpeggios start rolling down, you know, one after the other, and cascades, you know.
It makes us really proud to be human when we listen to a great performance of this piece.
Okay, let's have it. Maurizio Pollini in 1974 and the Schubert Wander Fantasy. Thank you. Not bad.
That's worth a standing ovation, I would say. Now, Pollini's playing, there is something so modern and steely about it. And I think we were talking about how perhaps the taste for listeners has reverted back to a more flexible, warmer type of playing. But it's undeniable that Pollini's playing is still incredibly attractive. And he's a hero to many, many pianists today.
He's the favorite of many, many people.
And I think this... his style of playing suits this playing. Well, it's certainly one type of interpretation of this piece. And I there's a lot that I could study from this recording.
Well, you're working on this piece and you're ready to perform it in what? In how long?
I am. In
do
about
you believe
a month.
That? Yes. Listeners, do you believe that our guest is going to play that thing?
Yes, October 4. It's a Thursday at Yamaha Artist Services. And
Can I come?
Of course. You are warmly welcome. And I'm very excited, especially because I'm programming it along with a sonata that Schubert composes a year after this, the A minor Deutsche 784, which is, although it's only a year, it's a world, it's a universe away. It's the A minor sonata is bleak, and it is composed during an incredibly difficult year of Schubert's life, where he is emotionally and physically shattered. And to contrast this with the youthful energy and optimism of the Wander Fantasy, I think is very interesting. It's an emotional journey for me.
I wanted to mention that it's been a while since we've actually identified you. So I want to make sure that our friends at home know that you are Lisa Yui, and you're a wonderful pianist who teaches at the Manhattan School of Music and has for some time, and Montclair State University. And you've played everywhere, all over the place, have fans everywhere, have won competitions, and you're a serious, great keyboard artist, as we like to say here.
Oh, there's nothing I love more than geek talking about piano music with you. So it's a really wonderful pleasure. So shall we move on to the future after the composition of the Schubert Wander Fantasy? We reach now to Franz Liszt, right, who was born in 1811. And it's really small wonder then that Liszt, who is famous for what we call thematic transformation, which is a technique where it's a kind of a Beethovenian mode technique, but Liszt often took little tiny rhythmic or melodic snippets, motifs, and he would expand upon it. He would transform it throughout an entire piece to a point that often it's almost unrecognizable. But it's a type of a variation, so to speak, but much more complex than that. Mm-hmm. And so Liszt, who was a master of the transformation of themes, received vital inspiration from Schubert's Wander Fantasy. And as you know, Liszt was a fervent champion of Schubert's music. And I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that perhaps without Liszt's support for Schubert's music, that is to say, his actual performance of Schubert's piano music and the transcriptions, the numerous transcriptions that Liszt composed of the Schubert songs, Schubert may have been in danger of disappearing from our world. Liszt was a hero, really, for many, many composers, including
absolutely.
Schubert.
Absolutely.
He was an amazing man who should not be viewed simply as a big, flashy showman.
And in fact, really, Schubert's music remained unknown for quite some time into the next century.
Yes, I mean, without Schnabel performing
the
Schubert sonatas. I mean, no one knew the Schubert sonatas. And to this day, actually, I still have many very talented, intelligent piano students and piano pianists in general who say, well, you know, Schubert, he's kind of a second-rate Beethoven. And that, I don't want to judge, but I do.
I just read something about Ernst Krenek, the composer who slighted Schubert in that way. But then he said, but then I looked carefully. Then I looked harder, you know, into the music, and he completely changed his mind. Because he thought he was just kind of a facile, you know, kind of tunesmith, you know, without any real organizational, compositional chops.
I wonder where that comes from. I think the first danger is comparing it, his sonatas to Beethoven's, because these are not in the same world at all, right? Schubert, indeed, I mean, his focus lies in his ability to modulate, his mastery of harmony, and the endless melodies that flowed from his brain. 600 songs, right? During his incredibly brief life.
31.
31. And the last 5 years, he was painfully ill, and yet his productivity never wavered even during those years. He's a miracle, truly. But I think one danger of performing Schubert incorrectly is to treat him as this frail, sweet, angelic creature, right? Effeminate Beethoven, almost. Because his music is energetic. It's there's a lot of hot blood in there. There's a lot of masculinity in there.
It's almost Chopin-like in that sense, right?
I mean, that's kind of another musician composer who people mistakenly consider effeminate in many ways.
But sick room talent.
Sick room, yes. The nocturnes are music for the nocturne for the sick bed, as it's been described
by John Field.
Yes, and we were talking during this. The performance of Pollini's Wander Fantasy, how the biographers of Schubert tend to treat him as this this weak, his nickname was Little Mushroom, right? Poor Schubert.
Well, I'm going to start calling you that.
But actually, one of his friends described him in a letter that Schubert's body, strong as it was, succumbed to the cleavage in his souls, I would put it, of which one pressed heavenwards and the other bathed in slime.
Right? Ew!
Yeah. But this understanding that he was an incredibly human person, you know, a man, that he lived in the world, he had his flaws, he had his passions, and the music must be treated as a real life muscular entity.
How was his letter writing? Do we have his letters?
Yes, we certainly do. There's actually many letters, especially during the years of his illness. And he was a wonderful writer. Do you want me to read you one from a very painful letter from 1824, right? This is a letter that he wrote to his friend when secondary syphilis had descended upon him, and he had lesions in his mouth and his throat, aching bones and so forth. And he wrote this. 1824, we have to remember that this is a 26-year-old man, should be at the height of his health and hopes and so forth. And he wrote, "I find myself to be the most unhappy and wretched creature in the world. Imagine a man whose health will never be right again, and who, in sheer despair, continually makes things worse and worse instead of better. Imagine a man, I say, whose most brilliant hopes have perished, to whom the felicity of love and friendship have nothing to offer but pain at best, whose enthusiasm, at least of the stimulating variety, for all things beautiful, threatens to forsake. And I ask you, is he not a miserable, unhappy being?" And now he quotes a few lines from Goethe's Faust. "My peace is gone, my heart is sore, I shall find it nevermore. I might as well sing every day now this, for upon retiring to bed each night, I hope that I may not wake again, and each morning only recalls yesterday's grief."
Mm.
This is devastating. And to realize that at the same time, his pen is still flowing. And we're not talking about a few bars here and there. We're talking about thousands of measures of some of the greatest music ever written before and since then. It's a true miracle of will and inspiration.
Wow.
Oh, but we were talking about Liszt, weren't we?
Yes.
Yes.
I asked you about the letters.
Yes.
And there you were, so, with a letter in your hands, like half a second.
Oh, it was from my mind, right? From my memory. So Liszt, as I mentioned, was a champion of Schubert's music. And we can hear this, the influence of not only Schubert's Wanderer Fantasy, but also Beethoven's Opus 27 sonatas. In Liszt's Dante Sonata, which was subtitled Fantasia Quasi Una Sonata, which is fantasy in the style of a sonata, which, it's a switch around of the Opus 27 sonatas of Beethoven, which were published as Sonata in the Style of a Fantasy.
And clearly he was conscious that it was switching
the
Beethoven.
Yes, absolutely. And so Liszt was experimenting with this single movement work or fantasy that is kind of subdivided into sections like a multi-movement sonata. And a great example of this is Liszt's masterpiece for the piano, the B minor sonata, which is also a sonata. He calls it a sonata, but it's also a quasi-fantasy because this 30-minute work is a single movement work. We don't have any movements dividing this piece,
right,
but it's clearly in sections that have characteristics of a classical sonata. So the first section it's very muscular and virtuosic. The second section is like a slow movement. There's a third section that's like a scherzo. And then the fourth movement, a fugato, is a vivacious finale. And another element of a fantasy of this work is that Liszt only uses 5 themes in the entire duration of 30 minutes, and he simply transforms these 5 themes to create this massive structure. So shall we play a little bit of the sonata? I wanted to play two really important motives from the sonata near the very beginning of this work. First, there's a defiant theme characterized by a descending seventh. Bom, bom, ba-dum, ba-ba-ba-bum, right? And then immediately following that, there's a rhythmic motive that's, you know, some have described it as a knocking motive. Some have described it as kind of like an evil laugh, right? So let's play a little snippet of this. This is the beginning very early on in Liszt's B minor sonata performed by Vladimir Horowitz. Isn't it a great performance?
Beautiful.
Yeah,
it's dramatic.
Very dramatic.
Melodramatic, I might say.
I actually like to perform the sonata a little more straightforward manner because it's such a long work and it's such a clear structure. But when I listen to something like this, it makes me want to really juice it up.
I always think of the 1940s Universal films when I hear that terrible thing to have to think of when you listen to the Liszt sonata. But they used orchestrated versions of this to begin movies like The Mummy's Curse and things like that.
Silent films. You could use this definitely in so many movies. Now, 20 plus minutes later, we hear the beginning of what sounds like a scherzo movement. And you'll hear very, very clearly these two motives being transformed, right, in a fugal manner. So you'll hear the descending seventh motive in a kind of a more puckish manner, and then you'll hear the laughter in a lighter, more sardonic manner.
Serious playing.
Yeah.
I mean, and composing as well.
Exactly. Yes. This section, I mean, this entire piece, but the buildup of this section is so masterfully done, and how that, the almost the evil laughter, it in turn becomes humorous and then charming, and then gradually it becomes truly threatening, right?
You know, it took me a long time to appreciate the Liszt sonata. I think there were times when I actually, when we were talking back when we first met, that I was telling you that I didn't really like the Liszt sonata that much, you know.
Uh-huh.
But when you hear people like Horowitz play it, you know, that's so important.
Yes.
It makes all the difference.
Yes. Yeah. You need a great performer in order to realize the greatness of a work. And you can even actually take a second rate piece and make it great depending on the performer.
One thing I found out from listening also is that when you listen to a great performance, and this is really the point, when you listen to a great performance, what you hear, the thing that you hear ultimately is the greatness of the composer.
Yes. Yes.
A great player can do that.
Yes. And a mediocre or a bad performer could make a great work really awful. And so a program like yours is so important, because what you're doing is you're training the tastes of your listeners. And once we hear great performing, we start to recognize, I think it's easy to recognize bad playing, but what's more difficult to identify are the mediocre ones.
Well, I don't know. There are so many Richard Clayderman fans out there that I wonder about that.
Not mentioning any names, right?
No, we would not do that.
But it's a joy to recognize greatness in general, but great playing opens up the doors to a whole world that is so pleasurable to live in.
And what you said, which is kind of the opposite, is also true, that a great player can even make a mediocre piece sound good.
Yes.
And in a way, that's saying the same thing, except you have to dig a little deeper to see any greatness.
At times, I think today we have a tendency of simply performing great works like the Liszt sonata, which in a way plays itself, right? I mean, that's I could already hear many people saying, what are you talking about, you know? But what I'm saying is, if you play the notes, if you do what Liszt says, you have the technique to be able to play all the notes, it's going to sound pretty good.
This
right?
is a point we've made yes. over and over again through uh-huh. the years. And that is, it's not bad playing that will spell the ruin uh-huh. of music. It's mediocre playing.
Yes, yes. I think it's a lot of fun, though, to take really good mediocre or second-tier compositions. And Dušek, for example, I think we both love the Czech composer Jan Ladislav Dušek, but you have to admit that many of his compositions don't play themselves.
Absolutely.
There are some awkward things. If you play them all the same tempo, some parts will drag and so forth. And the fun is to recognize what are the parts where I have to help the composer a little. Mm-hmm. And when you do that, you could make a fantastic performance and create a great work out of something that's not quite so great. And in many ways for a pianist, I think that could be a very important exercise.
Quite.
So Liszt, we tend to kind of drag, you know, wander away from Liszt. But, wow, that was an awful joke.
No, that was really clever.
Really? Thank you.
Yeah.
So Liszt certainly was familiar with Schubert's Wanderer Fantasy. He came back to it many times. He made an edition of it, which I think is fantastic. Many people consider this edition to be a crime, you know, because Liszt adds many things. He makes it much more symphonic by adding pedals, adding chords to make the textures more dense. There's also a two-piano version of the Wanderer Fantasy, which again emphasizes this idea that Liszt wanted to make this orchestral, right? He wanted to make it something more than piano. And if that wasn't clear enough, he has a transcription of the Wanderer Fantasy for piano and orchestra, which for many years was, I think, the only version that was known because people really did not play Schubert, but they were familiar with the Liszt transcript, the kind of the concerto for piano and orchestra of the Schubert Wanderer Fantasy. And so I would love to play listen to the first movement of this.
It's going to leave us hanging a little bit.
It will, because it's not going to conclude
with
a proper cadence.
That's all right.
But you just listened to the original piano version, so you'll recognize the kind of what Liszt does with it. He opens the entire piece with an orchestral introduction, no piano. And when there's the restatement of the main motive, that's when the piano enters. And it's interesting to see how certain melodic fragments are given to the orchestra, often as woodwind solos. And when you get the chance, we won't listen to the other movements today, but the second movement is fascinating in that he opens with the piano solo.
Liszt liked woodwind solos. I mean, his concertos have wonderful woodwind solos.
He certainly did. He, many of his orchestral works, the woodwinds represented something often pure and goodness, right? The Faust Symphony, for example, the slow movement is given a woodwind solo as well. And the terrible, awful arpeggios in the end of the third movement, where, you know, it's kind of the nightmare for all pianists, are much easier in this version. Because,
I was thinking it as I was listening to it.
Yeah, the piano has solid chords, and then there are huge fanfares in the orchestra. So
you can use two hands, for example, sometimes. Right?
Yes, but I mean, there are fewer notes for the pianist to have to play.
Right.
And there's a lot of noise still because the orchestra is there. And so sometimes I wonder, you know, when I'm performing the original version, I wish the orchestra could enter just at that moment. So let's listen to the first movement of the Liszt transcription of Schubert's Wanderer Fantasy. This is performed by the Hungarian pianist Jenő Jandó.
Thank you.
we end with the beginning of the song theme. Great stuff.
Yano Yondo playing Schubert's, Liszt's transcription of Schubert's Wander Fantasy. How fun is that?
Great, right?
Yeah.
It really catches the ear, doesn't it?
I think so. And I think it helps the pianist interpret the original Wander Fantasy in a different way, in a much more symphonic manner.
Lisa Yui is our guest today on Morning Irsay, has been our guest today. Lisa, always such a pleasure. Let me invite the listeners to your October 4th concert of Schubert and Liszt at the Yamaha Artist Services. They can find out everything they need to know at your website, which is lisayui.com, Lisa as in L-I-S-A and Yui.com. And they can read more about you and your history and what you've done and what you will do and what you're fated to do.
Thank you so much, James. It's always an enormous pleasure to be here.
Well, it's always great to have you. And as you know, the door is always open for you. So here's some familiar music. That's our outro music. Lisa, thank you so much.
Thank you. Always nice.
And I think it was a fun program. Fun for us, I think. I hope it was fun for our audience. Okay, James Irsay here, along with Lisa Yui. We both wish you a happy, happy weekend. Bye, everybody.